17 by XXXTentacion really means a lot to me. It was kind of the album that really kicked me off on him, even though I had already kind of been following him for a short bit since that point. Not too long, I wasn't there in like 2015, 2016, but I mean, Look at Me was obviously the first song that I heard from him, and from there I instantly deep dove into his SoundCloud stuff that was already out there, and 17 was an extremely welcome surprise. I think I was about 13 or 14 whenever it had came out. And it was one of those albums that when I listened to it gave me such a weird feeling. Not only was it the sound that I had expected from him, but it was something completely different. Coming in at just over 20 minutes long, this very short 11 track album packs a lot in it. I think a lot of people to this day have kind of concluded that it is probably one of the greatest albums to come out of the SoundCloud era of hip hop, and definitely one of the biggest symbols of that era specifically. Now, when you talk about SoundCloud era hip hop, there's a lot of other people to mention there. You have Ski Mask the Slump God, you have Lil Uzi, you have Denzel Curry, you have a ton of artists that popped out at that time that really got a one big song to take off, and since then it's just been a roller coaster. They've been continuously putting out good music, specifically Denzel Curry is just one of the greatest to come from that era of hip hop. You've seen during that time period a lot of different things switch up. I think specifically emo hip hop and these more just heavy, kind of rough, unmastered, unmixed sounding tracks coming out of SoundCloud were very unique and caught a lot of the younger people's ear in a very weird way that nobody had really seen before this point. Being somebody who at the time was in high school, you really got to see these songs take off and these artists really begin to spiral into these crazy mainstream artists, from being somebody that was recording songs in their bedroom on a Blue Yeti microphone to now, you know, being mainstream artists doing like world tours. It was one of the most crazy, just awesome things to see. But X had an insane rise up, from being in jail when Look at Me began to take off all the way to him releasing 17. It was already a pretty crazy ride just to see unfold. He was in jail when Look at Me took off and was immediately being offered deals as soon as the song hit its peak in popularity at that time, and he ended up signing with, I believe, Empire Distribution. He would go a couple of months after getting out of jail releasing some singles here and there on SoundCloud, and then ultimately releasing 17 in the spring. And 17, from top to bottom, was one of the coolest, most unique first listens I've ever had of an album. Building on from a very short period of time that he had to actually sit down and record that record, if from anything that he didn't already have recorded prior, he, I feel, packed a lot into a very short amount of time. And again, I think it's one of my biggest complaints with his discography overall, but the fact that the album was so short is the only real negative that I have to it. The majority of the album feels like it's the perfect way to introduce the mainstream to X, and it was also, I think, the perfect culture shock to see people that had only known him for Look at Me now hear him do stuff like Orlando. It was a very big risk as well from him to put this kind of a body of work out there when people expected more of Look at Me, which I don't think they really got anything of like that from 17. At least you did have hit tracks on there, obviously Jocelyn Flores, Everybody Dies in Their Nightmares, you had Fuck Love, which is, all three of those are just absolutely banger tracks. I even think they have like well over like a billion streams each of them. I think Jocelyn Flores has well over 2 billion streams. They had hits on that album, and it's an album that if you played for anybody before they knew who he was, I don't think anybody would tell you, oh yeah, this song will be a hit, this song is going to, you know, be huge. But that album has multiple huge, massive songs, and at the end of the day, sales aren't everything, but it's so cool to see that something so unique sounding at the time could elevate to a level that I don't think anybody would have been able to put their money on. And knowing that he kind of started off just trying to change his life by doing music, and now seeing it kind of come to fruition at that point, it was one of those moments that I think for most kids would really put you into the perspective of you can do anything as long as you just try. 17, again, I think is probably his magnum opus. I think it was the perfect body of work to encompass everything that you needed to know about X as a person. And obviously he did follow it up again with another good record. Question Mark was a beautiful second album, and I think it heavily elaborated more on those alternative sounding tracks. There wasn't much of the straightforward kind of rapping like Jocelyn Flores or Everybody Dies in Their Nightmares. I think it elaborated a lot more on the pop alt rock kind of sound that it had going on it. I do think still that 17 is better, even though again Question Mark is a longer record. I think it's about 18 or 19 19 tracks long, but still relatively short for that amount of songs. It definitely still had a lot backing it, and I think that if he had lived long enough to actually complete Skins, I think it still would have been a great album, with a shorter runtime, but still a pretty stacked track list. And I'm sure if you're watching this video, you already know, unfortunately, we did lose X. I actually remember when that whole thing was unfolding, I was in a PlayStation party chat with some friends, reading the news happening live as it was unfolding on Twitter, and it was one of the first moments that I'd ever really had an artist that I love die. The sudden realization of, like, that's it, there's no more to come, there's no more of this person, there's no more seeing this person do cool things, there's no more seeing this person release music, there's no more anything. It kind of stung. It really hurt as a kid. Now being older, seeing how horribly managed his legacy has become is one of the most terrible, shameful fucking things ever. And I think anybody can agree with that as well. Since his death in 2018, his label pretty much just kind of ran with it, and I don't even think most of it's to blame on his label. The majority of it, as far as I'm aware, is his estate, who mostly controls a lot of his releases. And again, I could be totally wrong with that, but this is just from what I know, what little research I have done on this. But after his death, it was announced that they were going to release his, at the time being worked on, third LP, Skins, but it was already put out there that it would be extremely short. I think the quote was like, it would just be a minute or something like that. And the album did release. It was a 10 track, barely 20 minute long record, with I think Travis Barker and Kanye West as the only features on it. I mean, for what it was a fine enough record. I think it got enough of the point across, and I can commend them a little bit for not using a bunch of older, unreleased snippets from SoundCloud and stuff like that, and instead just putting out what he had actually intended to be Skins the album out there. But past the release of Skins, everything got horribly, horribly mismanaged. All the way up to them releasing the documentary, and then putting out another album to go alongside it, which was just a ton of SoundCloud re-releases. On top of that, Bad Vibes Forever, the album that he had been hyping up since, I mean, he really got big, and since he had really started in like 2013, 2014, since he had kind of established who he wanted to be, releasing that album, and it being just clearly the biggest throwaway, label, money-hungry, trash album you could ever think of. It is just so fucking shameful to see how people have taken his career and ran it into the ground. And despite how you may feel about the guy, I do think that if you build something to this level that helps this many people, you, no matter what, deserve to have it taken care of in a way that you would want it to be. I think one of the best examples of posthumous releases and posthumous care for somebody's legacy is Mac Miller, for sure. I mean, they gave him, I think, about a year and a half after his death, or shortly just over a year before they released his final album, Circles, which again was not a finished record, but the person who was working on it the most at the time with him decided to try to finish it up and take what they had completed and put it out there. And that album turned out fantastic. But since then, there's no crazy, you know, 17 new features with Mac Miller, there's no 6 more albums from Mac Miller, there's none of this, none of the bullshit, none of the stupid, we have this song that we can put out there, and this song, and this song, and this song. And it's just one of the worst things to see. I don't have an issue with people re-releasing music from an artist, but at the same time, when we're now years past his death, I do have a problem with you milking any song that you haven't put on Spotify yet from his SoundCloud days and putting that out there. It's shameful, it's disrespectful, and it's fucked up on every level. To somebody who made music that helped a lot of people, it is even more shameful. And again, like I said, depending on your opinion of the guy, I know he had a past that a lot of people didn't agree with, but I still think if you're able to put out stuff like this, you can at least recognize the art for what it is. And it did still seem like he was trying to turn around his life, even all the way up to the release of 17. I remember on his YouTube channel, he did a lot of giveaways. He would give away consoles to kids, just giving away a lot of stuff to people, specifically kids, trying to help the kids out, local kids around the area in Florida that he just wanted to, you know, provide stuff for, give them these things to let them, you know, use to better themselves. And I can fully fucking appreciate that. I remember he even just seemed like a fun person. His YouTube channel, he would upload gaming videos, he'd upload vlogs, just some of the coolest shit to see an artist do to show you their personal life, especially at the time. But again, 17 was just one of the most amazing fucking albums I can think of. And I know this video was kind of a rant and kind of went off more on his legacy being tarnished and kind of going deeper into things that, you know, they did post 17, but I do truly believe 17 was one of the greatest, if not the greatest album come out of the SoundCloud era of hip-hop. And even though it didn't solely release on SoundCloud or whatever, it definitely proved that that generation was special and had something special, and specifically X had something amazing to say to the world. And unfortunately, to this day, he, you know, still has his legacy being tarnished by his estate. and by his label, and I don't know exactly what the deal is with all that on their side, but I mean, we're slowly seeing the same thing happen with an artist like Juice WRLD, who keeps having features come out like from nowhere. They've been for the past 3 or 4 years hyping up his final album, The Party Never Ends. They've just been doing the same thing with him as well. And I think at the end of the day, the one person who I feel the worst for in this whole scenario is Ski Mask, the Slump God. He really has lost 2 great friends, and he's even vocalized before that it's been difficult for him. But it's just really, really shitty to see somebody have to deal with that and still try to continue being a very public figure. But I mean, at the end of the day, he at least goes out there with a smile on his face. And obviously the music is targeting the youth, and to anybody that can go through the shit that he went through and still come out there and do that, I commend that wholeheartedly. That's insane that you're able to do that, and the fact that you don't crack under pressure is also insane. So if by any chance Ski Mask is watching this, you're a champion. I fucking love you, and I hope that everything goes good for you, because goddamn it, man, you deserve it at this rate. But absolutely, 17 from top to bottom is one of the best fucking albums to come from that era. And I think it's XXXTentacion's Magnum Opus. And that's going to be it for this video, guys. If you guys did enjoy it, be sure to hit that like button. Also, be sure to hit that subscribe button down below and hit that bell for notifications every time that I upload. Been doing a lot of videos like these, and I've been just having a lot of fun with them. But a lot of good music's about to be coming out. A lot of reactions are going to start coming out. So I can't wait for that as well, man. But again, let me know what you guys saw down below. Let me know if you guys would like to see a video on Question Mark. I would love to also talk about that for sure. Let me know what you guys think down below. And yeah, it's been Beckman. Peace out.